They say that in your subconsciousness, when you are in the womb, in the body of your mom, the first music you listen is the liquid inside your mom. And also, this is a kind of filter from all the noises around. It's probably something I always try to express. This kind of woomy, if I could say that, type of impression that the soundscapes, the first soundscapes, are those ones.
Jean-Michel Jarre introduced electronic music to millions and millions of people.
I was hooked by the melodies and the power of his music.
Il a créé son propre univers. Il y a deux manières d'avoir du succès dans la musique, c'est de faire quelque chose de très commercial ou de créer son propre produit. Et lui, il a créé son style, et personne d'autre que lui ne faisait ça.
Everybody else had access to the same toys, but they didn't make such great music with it. So I just loved his music.
Such a legendary figure in electronic music, but he really believes in securing that history and pushing it into the future and constantly taking it to new places. I mean, that's incredible, and we really need those people to keep pushing. Yeah, he's a big inspiration for me.
At the very early stage, I conceived and considered the music I wanted to create as a kind of a traveling experience in my mind. For me, the idea of traveling is very linked to my creative process. The project I'm currently working on, Electronica, I mean, this collaboration album I'm working on now for 3 years, is all about traveling. I mean, meeting with people, going to America, to China, to different countries in Europe, to meet with people.
A schoolboy photo or an adult photo
And that gives exactly the organic progression you need.
Okay.
No, that's absolutely brilliant. I wanted to gather around me artists, musicians indirectly linked to the electronic scene or to keyboards who have been or still are a source of inspiration to me, and also that I felt a kind of link on an emotional point of view, an artistic point of view. To go physically meeting with people, I think that was the very important part of the project. I mean, to meet physically and to spend some time to get together, to get to know each other. And through this whole experience, I felt that today it was like a kind of initiation journey for me. And the fact that you go physically from one point to the other one, from this place here in the studio in Paris to New York, to Berlin, to London, to Vienna or Los Angeles, that changed the whole perspective of the project.
Hello.
Hello, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Fine.
For instance, the work with Moby. Moby carries this kind of melancholia or this very special sadness to everything he's doing. He's not a sad guy he's not depressive, but he carries that in the way he sings and the way, and I always been so moved by that aspect.
I remember an early article that was written about me. They described me as the Woody Allen of techno.
Yeah.
And I thought about it. I was like, it's true. Like, I'm bald. I wear glasses. I'm a New Yorker. And yes, like all other New Yorkers, we moved to LA at some point.
Yes, and having a special relationship with melancholia as well.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What actually, I really love on our track, I mean, this kind of nostalgic mm-hmm. melancholia, futuristic nostalgia.
Most of the people I've collaborated with, I've never actually met them. I just send music back and forth. And what was very interesting with the Jean-Michel Jarre collaboration is most of the work that we did together in my studio. Being in the same small studio in person, working on emotional music, I think creates some vulnerability that you wouldn't get otherwise. When I think about your project and the amount of time it's taken and getting all these different people involved, of course, you've made a record, but it's also, it's like an odd historical document.
One of the first piece of music I wrote was called Happiness is a Sad Song. And it's actually what I always probably looked for in music and in any kind of art form, this kind of contrast, contradiction almost between kind of apparent happiness hiding a kind of sadness. My parents split up when I was 5 years old, and my father was a musician, and he started to be quite successful, but it was totally beyond my understanding as a child. And I actually didn't realize that my father was a musician, because then he left to the States, and I've been raised by my mom in a small flat in the Paris suburb. My mother used to have that kind of great joy and hiding a kind of melancholia, and it was probably coming from the fact that she went in the... She's been a great figure in the French Resistance, and she's been in a deportation camp, and she survived, and she had a fantastic link with life. But also, I think that marked her mind and her feelings forever. My mother, she became very close to a woman who became a friend later on after the war. And this woman, called Mimi Ricard, opened the most popular club for modern jazz. And I remember that for my 7th or 8th birthday, I mean, Chet Baker sat me on the upright piano, because I was just the kid around. And he played for me for maybe 5 minutes. For me, it was like 2 hours. And even today, when I'm telling you this story, I still feel the air of the trumpet of Chet Baker. So that also, this is something very strong in terms of my emotional link with sound. Looking back at this period, I was really interested by abstraction and abstract art in painting. And I think this influence of abstract painting and jazz drove me to electronic music, because it's the same, this is the same language, the same grammar, the same vocabulary. In the old days, when I was studying electronic music, we had no sequencers, and I was basically doing loops with Scotch sellotape like this, and a razor blade, and some magnetic tape. And this is part of the project I'm doing with Air, and I like the idea of starting this piece with the first way of doing a loop with the beats, and this is the result when you push play.
Michel Jarre was kind of unique in his style, and also when we became successful with the French Touch and all these electronic music scenes in the late 90s and 20 years before, there was one guy who did that already. You know, it was Jean-Michel Jarre, and he was the pioneer of that movement.
When I started electronic music, we were just a bunch of kids. I mean, triggering and dealing with strange instruments, even not synthesizers, but just banks of oscillators coming from laboratories and very obscure type of machines. And we had no idea that these instruments would be considered one day as musical instruments, and even more like the almost the traditional way of doing music. And you can also doing a like a. This beast is a bit masochist as well, so it likes to be. Every DJ today is a grand son of Pierre Schaeffer, because this guy invented everything in the late 40s. I mean, looping, reversing, I mean, sound design and transforming, varying the speed of a sound, I mean, creating delays, creating loops even by scratching a record, a 78. I mean, the first people doing music with turntables were those guys in the late 40s. And the DJ world doesn't know this enough, because their roots are from here, this country, here in Paris, in this city, and also in Köln, in Germany, with Stockhausen. This is where it's all started. And this is the reason why, I mean, for me, it has been something that changed my life as a human being and as a musician. When I did Oxygen, I did that in the ex-kitchen of the flat I was living in at that moment. And it was probably the first home studio ever in days where serious music should be done in a serious studios with glass and one cabin and one recording studio. And I did that in a very modest way with just two or three instruments in my bedroom, basically. This obsession by creating a link between experimental music and avant-garde or electronic music in a totally different format than in the rock format, like people in the jazz or classical music would do, I mean, but just with electronic instruments. And that was something new for lots of people out there. Oxygen has been rejected by almost all labels. There is no singer and no drums, and tracks were lasting 12 minutes, and on top of it, I was French on a UK or American point of view.
comme musique pour rentrer, c'est pas mal, non?
Pas mal.
Ah, je sais pas si vous me laissez.
Not bad, hein? Do you remember when I played you Oxygen for the first time? Do you remember where it was?
Yes, and I was pregnant with David.
Yes.
And I went into the bath and I put lots of candles all around, a very nice hot bath, and I listened to it in the bath. I don't know why, it just sort of happened that I listened to it in the bath. Anyway, soaking. And I remember thinking that it was, I was completely troubled and amazed because I hadn't really heard anything like that before. And it was very haunting. It was very melodic at the same time, and there was no sort of particular structure that I'd really heard before in music. And so, do you remember what I said to you? I said, look, this is going to either be, you know, a sort of an overnight nothing, or it's going to be absolutely huge.
Yeah, I remember that. Yes, that will be nothing or more or less.
It'll be all or nothing.
Yes, exactly.
And it so happened, it was all.
It became an instant hit, very quickly. But I remember that two things. The first thing is, some of the when the album has been released, some people complain and send the record back to the record company, the album back, because they were saying that there is a technical problem at the beginning, because the beginning of Oxygen is starting with some white noise, a shh like this, and people were thinking that it was a technical mistake. And the other thing is, actually, I was walking in the Champs-Élysées and I saw Elton John and going out from record company, kind of Tower Records, there we had at that time, in with 10 copies, and I remember that my publisher was with me. I said, "Oh, that's a very good sign. I think it's going to work."
Et j'avais ce morceau qui passait à la radio, c'était Oxygène, qui restait dans ma tête. Et je crois que j'ai demandé à ma mère de m'accompagner dans un magasin de disques pour le trouver. Le problème, c'est que je ne savais pas qui était l'artiste, qui était l'auteur. Et j'ai dû chanter devant les vendeurs du magasin, j'ai dû chanter le thème. Et le vendeur a fini par me dire, c'est Jean-Michel Jarre. Je suis reparti avec le disque et je crois que c'est vraiment mon premier disque. Donc c'est oui, pour moi, c'est évidemment quelque chose de... Une référence hyper importante pour moi, et une influence aussi.
When I first heard Oxygen, it sounded like it was coming from just a different universe. And then I saw the cover art of the album, and I thought to myself, what is this? Because it sounded and looked so different from the world I was living in. You know, I was living in mid-70s suburban United States, and all of a sudden, this futuristic French European electronic music entered my world, and it made me see the world differently. And it was a combination of some of my favorite things, of beauty, futurism, and science fiction.
The music of Jean-Michel was the only music that I knew, which was the music of space. It was like the only instrumental music that could make me dream. Sometimes I was feeling lonely in my bedroom, and so it was like a warm moment for me to listen to his music. I could dream and feel melancholic and nostalgic.
And then I really worked on an impressionist approach to electronic music, what was exactly the reverse of what Kraftwerk would do at the same time. I mean, really having, I was obsessed by no sound in this album should be the same, should be identical. I mean, even sequences were done by hand. And or if it was not by hand, I was leaving and playing the sequencer from A to Z to avoid working with patterns. I mean, to create this kind of constant evolution, because, you know, I always been interested in electronic music, in the fact that even if you are a hypnotic, trancey type of structure, there is a big difference for me between waves you see on the beach, for instance. You can watch the sea forever, I mean the waves forever, for the whole day, and it's never boring. And if you just film 2 minutes of the same waves, and then if you're editing these 2 minutes into 1 hour, you are bored to death after 10 minutes. Why? Because actually, you feel the artificial repetition. And it's the same thing, like a heartbeat. The heartbeat is, you would die if the heartbeat was identical. Each heartbeat is different. And it's the same, but it's different. It's always what I loved with the idea of conceiving electronic music, is the kind of anti-pattern repetition. It's something with Equinox that I really tried to avoid, to have this kind of impressionist soundscapes. And I have a very special relationship with Equinox. I think it's one album, when I listen to it, what I really recognize as something that I had in mind, and it happened.
It was completely revolutionary, of course, then. And it was obviously just the right period. You know, he completely captured the, let's use the German word, Zeitgeist. And he was a major influence on me. I mean, he was a major influence on... I don't think there's an electronic musician that isn't influenced by him.
I realized with this album project that actually we almost all collaborators, their music or their style is slightly off
the beaten track.
Yeah, that's right. And I felt that
searches.
Yeah, and I felt this is, as we know, something we have in common. Even when we met, we were quite. I mean, your position in the cinema. Mm-hmm. In the movie industry is totally unusual and totally different and off and almost remote. And the same in my case. So we very quickly considered our family as a gang, as a tribe, where we were traveling together for some projects we thought was important for us. And then obviously going to China in the early 80s is far beyond just doing a concert. It's such an incredible experience that you have to share it with your family or with people you're in love with. It was quite natural. And also Charlotte, being a very good photographer, she went also there to capture the old story, the old saga, and it was totally natural and part. I mean, she was part of the gang, of the team, almost of the band.
When we went to China, it was just, you know, we only had, I only had a certain amount of films, I remember. I don't know we could even get them there, so much films, do you remember? wasn't it amazing?
Yes, it was.
I mean, what an amazing trip.
What happened with China is actually after the success of Equinox, somebody from British Embassy, just after the fall of Mao and the fall of the Gang of Four, after Mao's time, in 1980. They gave my albums to the public Chinese radio, and for the first time, Deng Xiaoping wanted to open a bit the door to the West, and then they played my music. And it was just such a shock over there, because for 20 years they were just playing Chinese music, and suddenly to listen to something totally different. Actually, it could have been anything, basically, but it was on top of it, kind of electronic music with unknown sounds and things, and it created a real shock. And then the idea came along to invite me for a concert. And it took another year, and we never knew actually who gave the authorization, because in those days such a paranoia was in China. People were, I mean, allowing something, were really scared to be in jail the following year. So we never knew, but actually in a very Chinese way it happened. And then here we are in Beijing and Shanghai, I mean, doing probably one of the most extraordinary show you could imagine. It was like playing in the moon for on both sides. After 1989, after the student revolution, I went back to play Forbidden City and Tiananmen Square. And I really learned by this, with this experience, the fact that I think it's not good to... I'm more and more against boycott, the idea of boycott. Especially in a country where artists are not allowed to express themselves. You have to go. Because it's the only way to create a change. We are becoming a bit political there, but even if governments are exploiting yourself, take the risk. I mean, China has changed a lot now, but in those days it was a bit difficult for artists. And I think that when I look back, I'm really happy about the contacts and the link I created with the Chinese audience, but also with the Chinese, the artistic and intellectual community.
And also what we liked also about Jean-Michel is he sees everything in big. For example, he doesn't have like two or three keyboards, he has like 100 keyboards. And the same for his shows, when he plays live, it's big shows and everything is in big. You know, you have like a big sound with big speakers, with a screen, with a big organization, and it's something like It's a big picture.
We got the idea to create a link with space. Ron McNair, one of the astronauts supposed to go in the next mission. Ron used to be a jazz player, sax player. And we decided that I could write a piece. I'm going to write a piece for him, special piece for him, and he could play this piece in the weightlessness of space. I remember just before takeoff, Ron calling me in Paris saying, everything's ready, see you in a week time, watch me on television for the takeoff. And then Challenger exploded.
We have a report from the flight dynamics officer that the vehicle has exploded, checking with the recovery forces to see what can be done at this point.
And I was so depressed. The astronauts called me. You can't stop now because it has to become, this concert has to become a tribute for all the astronauts.
I'd like to dedicate this next song to my friend, the astronaut Ron McNair. Ron's part will be played by Kirk Whelan.
There is a need, and an increasing need, to share an event together, physically, to be side by side. I mean, and like in the old days watching the eclipse, it was the same kind of things, and using visual elements was, I didn't know at that stage, that it was anticipating or promontory to all kind of big audiovisual scenography used by the rock scene later on. At a very early stage, I said to myself, I would like to join forces with visual elements and conceive a kind of show that could be like a modern version of opera, would use the visual technique of my generation, video, lights, lasers, I mean, all what I could find, and giant projections. If I'm the godfather of rave, I like this because the fact that you are able to hijack one place for one night and you have no second chance. And I always considered my concerts like that. Touring is something else, but having one-offs, it carries a unique romantic aspect, which is that for the audience and yourself, you have no second chance. It's like the acrobat in a circus. You do your trick, and you take the ultimate risk for the ultimate result is to create magic. And it's what I like, I mean, giving a rendezvous to some people. And we all know that what we are experiencing together is not going to be repeated. So it's when you are really sharing the events. And it's what, for me, where the magic of a performance is and will be. And also the idea of playing music outside was for me the part of the DNA of electronic music. I mean, for me, electronic music is much more like outdoor. If the rave movement started, obviously, outdoor, today these big EDM festivals are outdoor. I mean, I think electronic music needs the sky as the roof of the arena.
Tomorrowland, who's ready for some new music? This is the world premiere of a man that I've admired since I was a little kid. It's a collaboration between me and Jean-Michel Jarre called Stardust. Make some noise!
He was truly unique. His gigs in Moscow, you know, projecting the visuals on the buildings. And I was really inspired by that because right now in the dance music industry, we know everything about LEDs, lasers, you know, but he already did that way before the technique was even possible. I think I have most of his DVDs as well, just, you know, using as an inspiration for my own shows, and trance music wouldn't have sounded the same without his influence, for sure.
Jean-Michel Jarre is, for me, is a pioneer, you know. He did so much for electronic music, and especially for my generation of artists. I'm talking about Daft Punk, Phoenix, Justice. He did a lot for us, you know, young musicians.
Perfecto.
When you talk about the parents dying and having time, and you having a relationship with time, it means that you actually you own your time, because you know in a sense that your time is limited. You really know it's limited because they've gone. So you've got a certain amount of time, and that's all.
In a sense, you feel, I don't know, you feel for the first time being yourself.
Yeah, the only time, the first real time, you feel truly responsible.
Yeah, that's right. This place is very linked to my father, because my father used to live here in Hollywood for 60 years. And I always had a fairly difficult relationship with him. We were not that close. I grew up pretty far away from his influence. And my parents split up when I was 5 years old. And I never really get the opportunity to we never got the opportunity together to really get as close as I would have wished, probably. It's funny because I always had a kind of psychological problem with this town. It was actually very familiar, and at the same time, I always considered it was a little bit the father's territory. I remember that I saw my father once. He was living at half a mile of the hotel, and we just had a kind of drink in the lobby of the hotel. Very nicely, in a very nice moment, but so strange that I was not able to visit him at his home, but just meeting him in the lobby of my hotel like a vague friend. And this is something that I've been quite shocked or marked or after that for years. He passed away now 5 years ago, and it's like if now I had to spend more time here, like if it was maybe the best place for me to be with him at last. And it's something that I feel more and more, and recently I spent more and more time here, and it's a way also probably for us to get together in this strange or spiritual way.
Déjà?
Yes.
Yeah. How are you? Nice to see you. Hi, Hans. Sorry. I don't know if you. How are you?
How are you?
Oh, fine yourself. Lovely to see you too.
Lovely to see you. Have a seat.
Thank you very much.
His father started to use a lot of electronics. Jean-Michel was obviously the one who started it, but it was interesting that his father would be drawn to the same tools and the same syntax and vocabulary in a funny way. I can't imagine that it was entirely an accident. You know, sometimes, you know, relationships are complicated. All relationships are complicated, and maybe sometimes there's a way that the father is trying to reach out to the son and doesn't quite know how to use the words or the language or whatever.
And I love the way it grows. I think that we are matching our DNAs very well, I think. That's what I like, and I'm so pleased that we...
Well, I like things which grow over really long.
That's right, exactly. And I think that it stops maybe too early, maybe?
Yes, I agree. When I speak English, I have a German accent. When I write music, I have a German accent. I think we have a European sense of harmony. We have a European sense of music more than anything, and our music is intensely European. And it's interesting that so much electronic music has been, you know, the machines were invented in America and Japan, and we Europeans figured out how to use them, or how to, you know, they became part of our vocabulary.
We are kids, and we grown up with our toys, but our toys today are bigger than when we were younger, probably. But they're still toys, and when we can be free in a room like this with some friends and doing lots of things, and we can fulfill our dreams and through sounds and dreaming about a piece of music which has not been done, in a sense.
Hello. Please touch me. Please don't. Touch me.
So again, the sequence is not at all processed.
I like that.
You know, the melody is totally broken.
Descends jusqu'en bas, tu sais. Alors.
I think that Electronica could be considered as an ultimate victory of nerds. Even by hiding this aspect with performances and with the music we were doing. I was in Pete Townsend's studio, and I was absolutely amazed by the number of iLock keys and USB keys he had, with so many different softwares and plugins and things. I mean, but in the same place you have all the legendary guitars and all microphones. And for me, this is absolutely the temple of a nerd. That created for me an instant friendship through objects, through items, I mean through this kind of and very familiar environment.
Okay.
I was quite remote in my life because of it was difficult for me to create contacts, in a sense. Even if it was easy for me to talk to anyone, but deeply it was a bit difficult. And today it's somehow a bit different. I must say that, talking about therapy, this Electronica project has been obviously the best possible therapy. What I realized in this, I mean, through this project, is actually how isolated we are as musicians. We have our families, we have our audience, our friends, like everybody else. But I realized that we are not connecting, and we are not connected so much to each other. Yes, you JM Premix, Gary.
Okay.
So let's listen to it. Kind of a lazy, blasé type of mood.
And so it might mean a lyric thing.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah,
you should not lose the interpretation, because the way you sing is, I think, it gives a kind of very elegant, decadent Oscar Wilde type of techno. Oscar Wilde techno, and I love that. I mean, I think there is this kind of very decadent things I love.
This is the best analog synth with the Monarch, and the 948, which is a kind of like this. You have 24.
Hi.
Hello, lovely. How you been?
Good.
Mwah.
Fine.
Pleasure.
How are you doing? You good?
Is it good? What is it, orange? Mmm, I love them as well. See you later, girls.
See you later.
Bye-bye, take care. Bye-bye. So, so lovely.
Jean-Michel, you know, we've gone out to dinner a few times. He's been around here. He's hung out with my kids. As you see, he's laid on the floor with my dog. Yeah, it's just great to have around. And it, that spills out into the projects that you're working on. That relationship, that closeness, that friendship that you build up spills out into the other things that you're working on. And that has to make it better.
By the end of the day, I've been really moved by the way people really dedicated and gave how much they gave to the project. You know, you remember when we met Fellini in Cannes?
Yeah.
And the extraordinary things he told us when he said, you know, I've always been convinced that I was doing a brand new movie every time.
Yeah.
And now, by more or less by the end of his life, he was realizing that actually he did always the same movie. And that really, I think, is a very good example of this, that actually whatever you do, you do the same.
Yes, you just do the same. And what happens with, that I find now at my age, and I'm sure you do with your age, because we're on the same paths, is that the fact of honing it, plowing the field with all that you can understand of your own authenticity. So you're not being part of a mod, you're not being part of a fad, you're not being part of, it's your journey, and you're bringing in what you need for your journey.